Hello everyone, my name is David Koplow, and I might be the only person speaking today who neither has a PhD nor is currently in a PhD program. I'm also a member of a small group of MIT students who will leave the Institute having never taken or taught a physics course. So you might be wondering, what on earth gives me any right to say anything to you about AI and education? Well, I was asked to, and I was asked to because of my role in a recent paper, or should I say rebuttal, that got a lot of attention online. I'm also no stranger to physics education. I've written over 150 simulations that have been used by tens of thousands of students to learn physics, chemistry, and biology. And I am also co-president of AI at MIT, MIT's largest undergraduate AI organization. But perhaps what contributes most valuably to my experience is not something that I've done in my past, but something that I wasn't able to do for a very long time. Read. You see, I'm dyslexic. I read my first book in seventh grade, but long before then, I was an avid reader. As a small child, it was through my dad, but as I grew tired of him falling asleep after just a few hours, I turned to audiobooks. And as those audiobooks couldn't teach me what I needed to learn for my courses, I turned to text-to-speech software. So in this way, text-to-speech software entirely redesigned how I understood education from a very young age. It meant that I could learn another way. I could access the content in the curriculum a different way. I was able to do things that I was good at, that I loved, and I was able to avoid the things that I really struggled with. And I'll admit, at the time, it caused me a lot of internal conflict. I thought I was cheating, especially because at that point in my academic journey, so much of my education relied on spelling and reading, and when I looked around to my peers, they weren't using the same tools that I were. But as I asked everyone in my life, whether it be my teachers, my peers, my friends, I got the same answer. Again and again and again. My use of this technology in this way was okay, because it allowed me to access education in a way that enabled me to move beyond these difficulties. And in my life at large, I'd be able to use these tools to learn the things that really mattered. Now, the question still remains, is it cheating now to use these large language models in classes? And here, perhaps it's important to draw a distinction, especially considering all the advances that we've seen in the past few years. There's a difference between helping a student and replacing the role of a student in education. And I guess for most of my life, I thought this notion of replacing a student with AI was just impossible. How could this be the case? AI helped people do things that they were bad at better, not what they were good at better than them. But a few weeks ago, there was a preprint that was released that claimed to do just this in computer science. It was a paper, a preprint, that was released and had 15 co-authors, including four professors from MIT. And it claimed to have a 100% solve rate on the entire MIT EECS curriculum using GPT-4. This paper was released on Twitter by the corresponding author and collected hundreds of thousands of views in a single day. And as with any viral machine learning paper, it ended up in my fraternity's machine learning group chat. What followed was a very late night with me and two of my good friends, Ronak and Neil, where we dived into this paper to try to understand how such a miraculous feat was possible. And what we found surprised us, because we found that it wasn't possible, at least not in the way that was detailed in the paper. And we wrote up our criticisms in a paper and then posted that on Twitter, which today it has 3.4 million views. And that response has also attracted the attention of many important communicators and researchers in the field, including LeCun, who spoke earlier today. And there was also an article written about it in the Chronicle of Higher Education. So what exactly about this paper and our response to it attracted so much attention from the field and deserved a facepalm emoji in the title of our response? Well, let's just say a good scientific paper has to have good code, it has to have good data, and has to have good methods. And there were problems with each of these three components. Now, in the data, just flat out, 5% of the questions in the released data set were unsolvable. And I'll tell you, maybe it's an open question about where the line is between large language models and cheating in academia, but it's certain that this large language model must have cheated in order to solve these unsolvable questions. Additionally, there was a suspicious amount of similarity between a lot of these questions that aren't representative of the normal problems that an MIT student has to go through and solve in MIT. And a number were also available online, which could have been part of GPT-4's training data. There were also typos in the code, meaning that it wasn't doing exactly what it claimed to be doing in the paper. And finally, there were problems in the methods. There was information leak and multi-shot. They kept asking the GPT-4 to re-answer the question until the answer matched what the actual correct answer was, evaluated by GPT-4. In fact, that evaluation of GPT-4 goes even farther because they, at the end of the day, they evaluated the accuracy of the response with GPT-4. And despite claims of manual verification, me and my collaborators were unable to achieve the same solve rate using even just zero-shot learning as they claimed in the paper. We only got 60%, they claimed 90%. And so from our perspective, there were so many flaws here that it was really surprising that so many co-authors would have overlooked all of these, especially considering how many professors were on this list of co-authors that had long careers of very, very impressive research. And what we found out a week later is that, in fact, most of the co-authors had no idea that this was being published as a preprint. And additionally, their data was released without valid consent. And because of all of these problems, this preprint was ultimately retracted. So this was a saga, and I think there are a few important key takeaways from it. The first is obviously that short timelines should not mean skipping science. And this should come, it should seem pretty obvious to a lot of you, but the problem is that these sorts of trends happen one paper at a time. This sort of atrophy happens one paper at a time. So this mechanism of evaluating the accuracy of responses using the state-of-the-art large language model has been repeated time and time and time again. And just one step beyond that is you don't even manually check it because you trust it. And so that was the problem here. It's really important to be careful of that, and also to be very cautious when evaluating these responses. And the final key takeaway is that being a student at MIT is very difficult. And I don't just mean this in the context of the large language models aren't yet smart enough to solve the questions that are expected of us as MIT students, but also that being a student, sometimes the most important things that you can learn are not what you learn in your class, but it's the skills and the values that you learn surrounding that environment and that process of education, such as being able to develop the tools to analyze when things in the world are wrong, identify them, and say something about that. Now, here, what we've determined is that, well, AI can certainly help a student access an education. It has been for a very long time. It's not quite able to replace a student in an education. But I think there's a lot to be said for possibly using AI to redefine what an education should be. Now, here is where I have to give an apology to this paper, because the initial goal was to reorder the prerequisites of MIT's EECS curriculum in a way that was more conducive to student success and helps them learn, which is actually a very noble goal. And while we might not be able to trust the conclusions of this paper re that problem, I think that is still an avenue of research that should be people should pursue. And in fact, I don't think we should stop there. There's a possibility of being able to prune the problems in a specific course based on the knowledge of the content and different prerequisites, or even selecting the problems that are most educational and help students learn the most. And all of this is in some vein helping students learn the content that's currently required of them to learn using artificial intelligence. And maybe we're taking feedback from the students, but there's something even more significant that I think is possible now that has never been possible before in all of human history. It's the ability to redesign what we're teaching the students, the actual content that we view as important in classes. Maybe we can analyze sources of textual language, such as autobiographies, to determine what experiences help a student discover a passion or be successful in their life and teach them to that early on. And maybe there's a way that we can determine what skills are most necessary for certain professions that currently aren't being taught by doing something as simple as analyzing the chatGPT queries from computer scientists. Now, the way we navigate these research questions strongly relies on a definition of education. And there's so many things that could work here. Is it the purpose of education to sate curiosity? Is it to think critically? Is it to be successful, or is it to have an impact? And frankly, I think that artificial intelligence can play a pivotal role in improving a student's ability to do all of these. Like never before, a student cannot get a question answered by asking a large language model. And do they not need to exercise critical thinking to assess the accuracy of that answer? And maybe to be successful and to have an impact in this new world that we're entering will require the knowledge of how to use large language models to benefit you and the way you pursue that. What used to be a tool to help a student with a learning disability perform at the level of somebody who didn't have one as now becoming a tool that can help somebody produce so much in their life, that the choice or the inability to not use these models is actually a handicap. Now, I can give you, this is a question that a lot of people in the field are going to have to wrestle with over the next few years, but I think I can give you my stance very succinctly here. Mens et manus, mind in hand, yet here I stand. In my hand a mind, and my mind redefined. Thank you.